By the way, another guy that we're waking up early because we want to find out his perspective is the voice of the Atlantic City Blackjacks. And a reminder, you can hear the game right here on 97.3 ESPN, and that is Nick Kosko. Nick, good morning to you, sir.
Pete, how are you, man?
I'm doing well, thank you. And I guess I'll ask you a non-Blackjack question first. What was your reaction to the Kawhi news?
Well, I actually set an alarm for this show today, considering this is my first day to sleep a little bit later after back-to-back 6 a.m. workouts. So then I actually ended up waking up around, I want to say 7:15. Then I see about 1,000 Twitter notifications on my phone, and then I have to, naturally, I figured, let me go back to sleep. I'll look at it later, but I'm like, wait, if it's Kawhi Leonard news, then I look at it, and they're all Woj tweets, and then I'm looking at it, and I see Kawhi Leonard to the Clippers, then I see the Clippers have traded for Paul George, and Kawhi Leonard made that happen, and so on and so forth. And I was actually fascinated. I honestly thought he was going to leave Toronto after digesting the news this week, and then I thought he's actually going to go to the Lakers because I figured, well, I mean, he can do it all. He's going to win a championship no matter where he goes at this point, so why not do it with the Lakers and grow up a Lakers fan? But in typical Kawhi fashion, he does the opposite of what you think he's going to do. He went to the Clippers, and I figured, okay, if he goes there, he could probably carry that team pretty far in the playoffs. But getting Paul George now, I'll tell you what, Kawhi Leonard, he might be, aside from LeBron, he might be the most powerful player in basketball right now.
It's unbelievable. 154, I believe, was the first Woj bomb of making it official, if you will, because, we all follow Woj to see what's happening. Now, of course, the Lakers get the consolation prize, I suppose, in Danny Green, but they don't get Kawhi. And, of course, that makes the Sixers instantly better.
It does, and I'm still of the opinion that the Sixers are, while they're really good on paper, I'm still worried about the lack of shooting. And then basically if you're the Sixers, now you have the expectation of, well, at minimum, you should be going to the Eastern Conference Finals. And then probably in reality, this is a team that should be in the NBA Finals representing the Eastern Conference next season with the talent you have on paper. But I'm probably still the minority with Sixers fans and people who cover and talk about the Sixers. Considering I do not think they necessarily got better than they were last year. Obviously they had lost J.J. Redick, and I was one of the guys who thought they would be better off bringing back a Jimmy Butler, but they lost him. They brought back Tobias Harris, but a ginormous contract. So if you're the Sixers, you better hope Tobias Harris takes the next step, and then. Obviously, if you're that Sixers franchise, it seems like Elton Brand is hinging the future on going all in with his team now. But obviously, the biggest dependents are Joel Embiid's health moving forward, and of course, the development of Ben Simmons. While a very good player, if he cannot take that next step to developing a mid-range game and being more of a threat to score outside the paint and making him more like a true point guard, and all the comparisons to Magic and LeBron, if really those don't pan out, then you're looking at the Sixers team probably going to be disappointing you next year. But I'll tell you what, it's wide open now, and there's no excuse now for the Sixers to not be in the NBA Finals next year.
There you go. Hashtag no excuses. Well, we can spend the whole time talking NBA, but we have you on because you're the voice of the AC Blackjacks. And this, last week was a must win, followed up now by another must win. If they're going to make the playoffs, they need to keep winning games. And it's interesting that it's the marquee matchup against the Philadelphia Soul, because in week one of the season, they gave the Soul everything they could handle, losing in Philadelphia 48-41. But what a different game it was by June 16th, where they lost 54-29. They lost their starting quarterback at that point. Things were on the slide, right?
Yeah, they were. And, if you go back to that week one game, I don't even count that the last game against Philadelphia for the most part. Then it was just a bad day all around. You obviously lose Randy Hipper, but that's when Warren Smith comes in, and then obviously he's played lights out the last two games at quarterback. But that week one game, yeah, that's one of the ones that really got away from the Blackjacks this year. One score loss, 48-41, as you mentioned, but that they were about to go up by three scores in that game. They had the ball inside the 5-yard line with a chance to go up, I believe it would have been 28-7 at a certain point in that game. But instead of, it's a 21-7 ball game at that point. And instead of going up by three scores, Hipper gets picked off by, the all-pro defensive back for the Soul, James Romaine, who's been great in this league for so long. He took it back to the house, and He made it a 21-14 game just like that. So it was a big 14-point swing, and Romaine had an additional pick six in that game as well. So, it was different teams back then, obviously, in week one. But, again, for the Black Sox, it's one of the games that got away. But, you can't control that now. And they're now at least in a position to make the playoffs. Obviously, if the Atlantic City wins out and they finish 6-6, they're going to get in. They actually still can get in at 5-7 as well. Only if they are tied for that fourth spot with Washington at 5-7, and they'll still get in. But, if you take care of business today, you're 5-6, put all the pressure back on Washington, and then, pretty much if you win today, then week 13 after the bye week for the final regular season game, it's a win-you're-in scenario.
Now, if I heard you correctly the other day, too, like the bye week is unusually late for the AC Blackjacks, but it's with the reason to then keep this marquee matchup, right? Everybody else is basically off except for the Soul and the Blackjacks?
Yeah, that's right. Yes, yeah, so everybody is off. I mean, I'm not sure what the league was exactly thinking with the bye weeks this year. Obviously, there's only six teams, so there's only so much you can do until the league gets expanded again for next year. Nobody's had a bye week until this week where they decide to keep Philadelphia and Atlantic City, the only two teams active this week. And this is obviously the first time Philadelphia's coming to Boardwalk Hall to face the Blackjacks. So it's going to be an interesting matchup today. It's going to be a raucous crowd, I would think, at Boardwalk Hall. And then all eyes from the rest of the league are going to be on this game because now, Philadelphia already clinched, but they still have an outside shot at the number one seed, and of course the Blackjacks are fighting for the playoff wise. So there's a lot on the line today for tonight's game.
Injury wise, so you talked about Hibbert going down and Warren Smith Jr. Of course he's just listed as Warren Smith on this list, but I like to throw the Jr. in there just to give senior some props. But there's also an injury at receiver right now too, right?
Kendra Gaines is down and out. He's not going to be playing this week. He's still on IR. His status is still up in the air, but, obviously not having him is tough for the Blackjacks. But in his absence, Antoine Grant has really stepped up. I mean, he's been that third receiver all year. Then once Ings went down, Grant has become he's been the guy in the slot and in high motion, low motion, wherever you want to call it, for the most part, on the offense. And he's broken out the last two games, scoring, he's going over 100 yards both games, and four touchdowns each. So, basically he's pushing 300 yards and eight touchdowns in the last two games combined. So he's really stepped up. You still have Lamarck Brown, who's the veteran presence, and he's been as consistent as they can be. And he can also run the football as well. And Rashad's still a rookie. He's really stepped up. Another rookie, he's really stepped up as well. He had 10 catches the other week. I know he didn't score, but he's been a big player. And obviously, you have guys. They brought guys in. Rashad Carter and Greg Carr. Greg Carr actually played for the Albany Empire last year. They just brought him in this week, so they added depth to their receiving core. They'll help out on special teams. So it's still a solid core. And obviously, with the way Warren's playing, the offense is still capable of scoring upwards of 60, 70 points.
Nick Kosko with us, the voice of the AC Blackjacks here on 97.3 ESPN, joining us on the Pete Thompson Show, getting up early on a day where I know he wanted to sleep in. Don't worry, Nick, next week's a bye week. We won't be waking you up, but I can tell you this. To me, my observation, this is my first year of really watching the AFL full time and seeing how the games turn out. High scoring, energetic, it almost, is it naive of me or simple of me to say that everybody can score? It's the teams that can come up with the key stop at the right time that are the successful teams in this league.
Well, you pretty much hit it right there, PT. The league is a little bit different this year. Obviously, you only have six teams compared to years past. We had upwards of, between 12 and 19 teams at some point. But aside from that, the rules are a little bit different from years past just because of the timing rules. So you have that running clock throughout the entire game until the 30-second mark of the fourth quarter. That's when you go back to traditional timing rules. But the AFL used to have, they used to have a one-minute warning, kind of like how the outdoor game has a two-minute warning. They used to have a one-minute warning at the end of each half. So the strategy is a little bit different. Obviously, the running clock all the time can limit scoring because, you used to have AFL games where the average scores would be in the 50s and 60s, and obviously you would reach the 70s and once in a while hit the 80s as well. So it's put the scoring down. It's sped the game up a little bit. I'm sure they'll probably look at it in the offseason, maybe modify the rule for next year, or maybe say it's good the way we have it. But no matter what, you could score from anywhere on that field. You could score in many different ways, whether it's offense, defense, or special teams. But yeah, you're pretty much right in terms of, you know, you win these games based on your stops. Or obviously, if you're the last one to score, you're the last one to score and you win the game. Or obviously, that's when the defense comes into play, and those stops are almost much more valuable in the indoor game than they are in the NFL or college, because that one stop could change games. And I look back at the game against Albany a couple weeks ago for the Blackjacks. They lost 63-61. That's a game they probably should have won, but you know, you have one tip ball for an interception, and Albany takes advantage of that. And because of the way the possessions are handed out, there you go. Albany did not get stopped at all that day. They ended up winning by 2 points, and that's the difference between the Blackjacks from being 4-6 today and 5-5. So it's just little things like that. So we'll see if the Blackjacks defense can come out swinging again on defense like they did last week when they only limited Washington to 41 points.
Again, it's the Atlantic City Blackjacks, 4-6 at home against the Philadelphia Soul. Blackjacks need this game tonight. We'll have another pair of tickets in the 9 o'clock hour. If you want to go see the Blackjacks in person, and we certainly thank the voice of the AC Blackjacks, Nick Costco, for jumping on board with us. Nick, go back to bed for a little bit, get another little power nap in there, and then we'll be listening to you pregame 6:30, right? And then the call is at 7 o'clock. Here are you and Coffee Jones.
That is correct, BT. And I think at this point, I cannot take a nap. Gotta get up, gotta, you know, make sure I got, gotta limber up a little bit, eat some breakfast, do some final preparation, maybe get a run in, and then head over to the arena, and then just, you know, chill at the arena for about 5 hours after I set up our fantastic equipment up in our booth, and then just, you know, observe the atmosphere of the game, talk to the guys, talk to the coaches, and do all the good stuff that great broadcasters do, you know?
Attaboy, I've seen your location there. You know, when we talk again sometime, we'll get more into what it was like, you with a wrestling background, to come call indoor football, and we'll map that out. But we're running up against the heartbreak, so listen, good luck tonight. Have a great broadcast. I know I'll be listening, and good luck to the Blackjacks. They need this one. We'll see how they do. If you can't make it out there, definitely tune in on 97.3 ESPN. Thanks, Nick.
Appreciate it, PT. Talk to you soon, man.
All right, buddy. Take care. Have a good call tonight. That's Nick Costco.